Hello and welcome. In our lesson today, we are going to discuss extraction of metals, specifically extraction of sodium metal. Now, before we proceed with the lesson, I would like to say this. I realize that this topic can be a bit challenging for candidates, especially with regards to certain metals like sodium. So I want to assure you this. By the end of this lesson, not only would you have understood all the concepts involved, but you will also find it easier to answer any related questions. So stick with me. Now, for the first part of our lesson, we are going to discuss occurrence. Now, this simply means what are the main sources of sodium or from which ores is sodium extracted. Now, there are three that I've written on the board. The first is trona. Now, trona is a double salt. This simply means it contains two types of salts. So with trona, there's sodium carbonate and there's sodium hydrogen carbonate. Now, as you can tell from the chemical formula, it also has water of crystallization. So this makes trona a hydrated salt. Now, trona is commonly found in salty lakes like Lake Mogadi. Now, the next source is dissolved sodium chloride. Now, this is usually found in oceans, salty water bodies. And the last one is solid sodium chloride. Now, this is commonly referred to as rock salt. It's the chief ore of sodium. Now, there are two reasons for this. Reason number one is that rock salt is abundant, so that makes it relatively cheap. The second reason is that little purification is required. Now, that is occurrence. Let's move on to the next bit, which is extraction. Sodium metal is extracted from rock salt through a process known as Downs process. Now, this occurs within a cell known as the Downs cell. Now, for this part of our lesson, I'm going to divide it into two bits. So for the first part, we are going to discuss the process that occurs within the Downs cell. For the next part, we are going to discuss the actual structure of the Downs cell. Now, in case you're wondering, why do we need to discuss the structure of the Downs cell? The reason for this is because quite a few questions regarding extraction of sodium tend to focus on the structure of the Downs cell. Why do we have this part? What is the function of this? And so on. So I find it very important. Now, for the process. Now, the method that is used to extract sodium from rock salt is electrolysis. Now, I know that this is a term that is familiar to most of us, but maybe just to remind ourselves what it is. Electrolysis is a process whereby electrical energy, electricity, is used to bring about chemical changes. These chemical changes then cause chemical decomposition. Simply put, electricity brings about chemical reactions which then cause the substances involved to be decomposed, to break down. Now, just maybe to make it clear why electrolysis is done. We are starting out with rock salt, which is sodium chloride. This is sodium chloride in solid state. Now, we want such that by the end of this process to have sodium metal and chlorine gas as the components that are produced. So electrolysis is utilized. Now, ionic compounds are capable of conducting an electric current. Therefore, electrolysis can be done on them. But there's a condition to that. They need to be in either of these two states, either in aqueous state, whereby they are dissolved in a solvent like water, or in molten state. Now, we have solid sodium chloride. So what happens is that heating needs to be done in order to melt it. So electricity is used to heat the sodium chloride. Now, I want you to imagine this scenario, whereby we have huge quantities of rock salt. Huge, remember this is an industrial process, huge quantities of rock salt that need to be heated such that they will melt. And just to put this into perspective, the melting point of sodium chloride is 800 degrees Celsius. Can you imagine the amount of electricity that will be required for such? It's going to be a lot. Now, in order to make this process economical, what happens is that an impurity is introduced. This impurity is calcium chloride. Let me take you back to your Form 1 work. In Form 1, you learnt about the effects of impurities in pure substances. So if you were to add an impurity to a pure substance, what happens is that it's going to lower the melting point. So the same thing happens here. If we were to add calcium chloride to sodium chloride, what happens is that the melting point of sodium chloride drops from 800 degrees Celsius to around 600 degrees Celsius. So this makes the process economical. It saves on costs. So calcium chloride is added for the reason it lowers the melting point of sodium chloride. And this is good because it makes the whole process economical. Okay, that is that. Now, before I proceed, I just want to let you know that electricity is used for two purposes. Purpose number one is that to melt the solid sodium chloride, which is what we are discussing right now. But heating needs to continue throughout. And the reason for this is because if the sodium chloride was to be molten and then heating was to stop, it will simply crystallize out. It will simply solidify out. So electrolysis is going to stop. So melting needs to happen, and then continuous heating needs to take place to ensure that the electrolyte, which is sodium chloride, does not crystallize out. Now moving on to the next bit, what happens at the electrodes? Now in electrolysis, we have two electrodes. These are the cathode and the anode. The cathode and the anode. Now, electrolytic reactions are redox reactions. That simply means that reduction and oxidation take place simultaneously. So this is reduction, oxidation. So these two processes occur at the same time. Now, it's just up to us to determine where they happen. Does reduction take place at the cathode or is it at the anode? Now, sometimes students confuse this too, but an easy way for you to remember is this. Red cut reduction happens at the cathode, and at the anode is where oxidation happens. So now we've determined that reduction occurs at the cathode, okay? So, another thing we have to remind ourselves is which of these involves the loss of electrons and which involves gaining of electrons. So, one of these involves the loss of electrons, the other gaining of electrons. Now, a very good way of doing this is by using that. So, oil rig. Oxidation is loss of electrons. And then rig. Reduction is gaining of electrons. So let's go where reduction is. So that means that whatever ions end up at the cathode are going to undergo reduction, which is gaining of electrons. Once we have that covered, we are now ready to proceed. Now we are going to write half equations of what happens at the cathode and at the anode. Now, sodium chloride, once molten, is going to have two ions. Sodium ions, positively charged, chloride ions, negatively charged. So the sodium ions are going to end up at the cathode, chloride ions are going to be at the anode. And our chloride ions. Just separate these two. So that means that if the sodium ions end up at the cathode, what will happen is that they're going to gain electrons. So sodium ion will gain one electron and be discharged as sodium metal. Now, what determines the number of electrons an ion gains or loses? The valency. Now, on the other side, at the anode, we have the chloride ions. So the chloride ions are going to lose an electron. They are going to lose an electron to discharge a chlorine atom. Now guys, I just want to mention this. The positioning of the electron is very, very important. Now students tend to ask, at the end, we are talking about the loss of an election. But why do we have a plus sign? Like, isn't this actually gaining? No. So what I tell my students is this. What happens in this? We are simply saying that this loses an electron to form that. So by doing this, we're just simply removing the electron. So we're just showing that it's actually lost. And then just to make something else clear, whatever electrons are lost at the anode are what are gained at the cathode. So these electrons that are lost by the chloride ions are those same electrons that will be gained by the sodium anodes. Now, let's pause here. Chlorine is diatomic. That means that when we write chlorine, we usually write it as such, Cl2. And the reason is because this is diatomic. So this is a chlorine molecule which consists of two chlorine atoms. So we need to form this Cl2. So if we want to end up with a chlorine molecule, that means initially we need to start with two chloride ions. So to now we come, And then, of course, if we have two chloride ions, each is going to lose one electron, giving us a total of two electrons. Now, the last bit, placing the state symbols, this is L for liquid because it's in molten state. And then this, of course, is going to be in gaseous state. Now, on this side, whatever electrons are lost at the anode are those that are gained at the cathode. So we need to balance the number of electrons in the two half equations. So what do? We simply multiply these by two so that we can end up having two electrons just like at the anode. So this gives us two sodium ions plus two electrons forming two sodium atoms. Sorry for this. Okay, now this and this are our two final equations. Now, one other thing I would like to mention is at the cathode, calcium is also discharged. Discharged simply means it's formed. Calcium is also formed. Now, before you panic and you're like, where is the calcium coming from? Let me just explain it to you. We added calcium chloride. We added calcium chloride in order to lower the melting point from 800 degrees Celsius to 600 degrees Celsius. So this is where the calcium is coming from. So a little bit of calcium metal is going to be discharged. Now, the point that I would just like to make is this. Calcium, I'm going to write it over here. So calcium metal is going to be discharged. But this does not pose any problem. In case you're wondering, won't the calcium mix with sodium and so on? No, it doesn't. And this does not happen for two main reasons. Reason number one is that they have different densities. Calcium is actually much denser compared to sodium. So it's denser than sodium. So what happens is that the liquid calcium that is discharged settles at the bottom. The liquid sodium, being lighter, settles on top and it can be easily tapped off. Now, another reason is that they have different melting points. So what happens is that on cooling, the calcium metal solidifies fast before the sodium metal and therefore can be easily separated. Okay. Now, I want us to take a deep breath, just a deep breath. Recharge ourselves before we move on to the next bit. Now, on to the last part. The structure of the Down's cell. Now, as I'm explaining this, I would like you to take a look at the diagram on the board. Now, I'll focus on these four main parts. Now, for the first one, the ion shell with bricks. Now, the outer layer of the Down's cell is made up of an ion shell that has bricks. Now, just to go back a little bit, when we talked about electricity, we said that electricity is used to melt the solid rock salt and also to ensure that it remains molten. So as you can imagine, we need to have a structure, or a structure is needed to ensure that as little of the heat energy is lost to the surrounding. This will end up conserving the heat energy, therefore saving on costs. So what happens is that this layer is present. So it ensures that the temperatures within the down cell are always high, therefore preventing the electrolyte, which in this case is sodium chloride, from crystallizing. Now, the next part is the electrodes. Now, as we mentioned, we have the cathode and the anode. Now, the cathode is made from steel. The anode is made from graphite. Now, this is what I want to focus on. The reason why the anode is made of graphite is because graphite is inert. It's unreactive. Now, at the anode is where chlorine gas is discharged. Now, as you know, chlorine is very reactive. So what happens is that because of the graphite, chlorine cannot react with it. Even though the temperatures are high, graphite does not react with chlorine. So that is the reason why the anode is composed of graphite. The next part, the diaphragm, the steel diaphragm. Now when I talk about the steel diaphragm, I simply mean a structure made of steel that is suspended between the cathode and the anode. So it separates the cathode from the anode. Now this is very important. We know that at the anode, chlorine gas is produced, and at the cathode, sodium is discharged. Now once this happens, we don't want these two recombining to form sodium chloride because it defeats the purpose. So they are separated by the steel diaphragm. So it prevents the sodium and chlorine from recombining with one another. Now the last part, the hood. The chlorine gas that is produced cannot be allowed to escape into the surrounding. And the reason for this is because chlorine is not only poisonous to individuals, but it's also harmful to the environment. So what happens is that it's usually collected. Now as you learned in Form 3, chlorine gas has a lot of uses. Let me just put it as such. It has a lot of uses. So it's not allowed to escape, it's trapped, and then it's used for other purposes. Now, just to summarize the lesson with this, the advantages of using the Downs process. Now, one is with regards to chlorine. The chlorine gas that is produced can be utilized for so many other different purposes. Another is that the ore that is used, or the raw material that is used, which in this case is rock salt, is abundant and relatively cheap. So it makes the whole process economical. This brings us to our last lesson. Please tune in to the next lesson, whereby I will be discussing past KCSE questions that focus on extraction of sodium. This will help you to know whether you've actually understood the concepts or not. But I hope you have enjoyed our lesson and you have benefited from it. Thank you.